The Sherlock Holmes Advent Calendar, An Odyssey to Jerusalem, by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Nora Godwin. Narrated by Brian Godwin. Part 22. The Star of Bethlehem. Normally, the road between Jerusalem and Bethlehem was busy, especially just before Christmas, due to the closure of the City of Peace by the Ottoman army and the fact that it was already late in the evening. Holmes and I met only a few pilgrims on the way. Apart from a greeting, we did not arouse any further interest. The approximately 6 miles that we had to cover on foot were completed in 2.5 hours, although Bethlehem was still slightly higher than Jerusalem in the southern Judean highlands. And so we arrived in Bethlehem shortly before midnight on December 22nd. Well, there you go, I joked. Although I was exhausted by the violent march, we reached the place without having to rely on the guidance of a celestial comet. Holmes remained serious. My dear Watson, he replied, in our case, it is not the Star of Bethlehem that would lead us into the city, but it's the other way around. We have to find the star in the city. I attached little importance to this teaching when we entered Bethlehem. The small town, with almost 4,000 inhabitants, was unique in Palestine, because it was almost exclusively Christians. It was mainly believers of the Greek Orthodox Church, but also so-called Oriental Latins, who were close to the Catholic papacy, as well as Armenians, who lived there. A little more than 30 years ago, the Ottomans had nevertheless built an unmistakable mosque with a high minaret in a prominent place on the central major square, almost directly opposite the Church of Nativity, which is so important for Christians. It was an early Christian building from late Roman times that was built exactly above the rock grotto, which at that time had been located more or less precisely as the presumed birthplace of Jesus of Nazareth. Since it was a sacred place for Christianity worldwide, I thought about how I could convince Holmes to visit the Church of the Nativity, because of course I wanted to see the place with my own eyes and understand it with my own heart and soul. But as soon as we reached the empty manger square, which housed a lively market during the day, from the side of the Omar Mosque, my friend came before me. "We will immediately visit the Church of the Nativity," he announced almost in command, and I had no interest in contradicting him. "Well," I commented, "if you insist." Of course, Holmes saw through me. "We are not here for tourist reasons or even for the purpose of a pilgrimage," he lectured me. "We are still under the mandate of the British government to fulfill the wishes of our Ottoman allies. It's about putting a stop to the zealot Popular Front." "Go for it," I replied with a smile. "Don't let it stop you." My friend was not going to be stopped anyway. The whole town seemed to be already asleep, and the surprisingly small gate to the outwardly quite unadorned Church of the Nativity had long since been closed. "Shall we knock?" I asked, and I was about to take action. But Holmes stopped me. "Not at all, Watson," he replied quickly. "We don't want to wake anyone up. On the contrary." With these words, Holmes pulled out his professional lock-picking tool out of his coat pocket and began to work on the door lock with a suitable Dietrich. I was deeply frightened. "For God's sakes, Holmes," I whispered as insistently as possible, "you don't want to break into the Holy Church of the Nativity." My friend, however, remained unimpressed and said succinctly, "Do you want to see the Grotto of the Nativity or not?" I acquiesced and let Holmes continue. Within 2 minutes, he had opened the basilica and we carefully entered. On the inside, the church was brightly lit by all sorts of candles and it seemed deserted for the night. "We're lucky," Holmes said. "No one noticed anything." "God sees everything," I returned, but Holmes was not deterred. Inside, the church showed its importance more impressively. It was lavishly restored, decorated with red velvet tapestries and golden cords. There were images of saints and ornate mosaics, and everywhere the seemingly indispensable censers were hanging from chains. Holmes unerringly headed for the central altar above the birthplace, as if he knew his way around here, and I followed him closely. I tried for a little spiritual grandeur, even though we had invaded the churches as burglars. The altar marked in an indentation exactly the place where the Christian Savior is said to have been born. Directly below is a small cave that has been traditionally venerated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.